Good morning, everybody. So I think, yeah, most of you are here. So let us start today's class. So let me share my screen. Okay, so I hope you can see my screen. Yeah. All right, so what we were discussing. Okay, so fundamentally the whole framework is on Bayes classifier still, but now we are moving on towards estimation. And in the estimation, what we have seen is so the estimation actually broadly. Okay, so okay, there is a problem. My window is choppy. Okay, just a minute. Okay, so estimation, there are two classes of it. So one is called parametric estimation. Okay, and another one is non-parametric. So in parametric, we saw MLE and we saw Bayes estimation. Okay, we saw Bayes estimation, but we still need to finish it up. And in non-parametric, there are techniques which are there, which will be used to estimate the class conditional density without any assumption on the form of the class conditional density. So here, the this was like you assumed a normal, you assumed a exponential, you assumed a Bernoulli, and then you estimated these parameters, either like MLE you did or you did Bayesian, but you assumed a parametric form. Whereas in non-parametric, you don't have such form, and it is, yeah, so it is a different method. So here, even with non-parametric, you can do Bayes classifiers, but we will not dwell with that in this particular course. Okay, but this is a whole area on its own. So I would like to now move on a little bit in Bayesian. So in the parametric space itself, okay, so if you just focus on parametric space itself, what we have looked at is forms which are simple, okay, which are like a single density. So like, you know, you either it's a normal or it's an exponential, stuff like that. So this we saw, and today if possible we will try to go to mixture densities. Okay, so let me just anyway briefly motivate what is mixture densities. So like I was telling, the idea in a Bayes classifier is you assume class conditional densities, and then you assume that those class conditional densities have a certain form. Okay, so for instance, I said that human height based on the gender has some form like this, right? So this perhaps, you know, because of the physiology, typically there is some kind of a difference between men and women in terms of their heights. Okay, so this happens. And yeah, so there is some difference like this. But now what I'm trying to say is this may not be a fair assumption all the time. Okay, so then sometimes, you know, the geography also plays a role. So people from certain region tend to be taller for various reasons. Okay, let's not go into that, but there will be some within certain geography, people will be of certain height. So for instance, if I'm not wrong, I think people from this Netherlands, they tend to be tall. So whereas people from France are not so tall, something like that. There is some study which can tell all these details. But the point being, if we just focus to one group, so let us say this is males and this is females. Okay, so now what we are going to do is, even in females, it is completely not fair to assume that there is a normal distribution like this. Perhaps it is much more better represented by a mixture of normals. What it means is each region, perhaps some region A has height distribution like this, and region B has height distribution like this, and then region C, which has a fewer number of people, may have height distribution like this. Okay, in total, what you get is a mixture of Gaussian densities. Okay, so this is then the shape of the density will look with like something like this multimodal feature. Okay, and this is called as a Gaussian mixture model. Okay, so these are called as GMMs, and there are several applications of GMMs, and it's very very practical. But we will come to that. So essentially, what is the problem in this GMMs? Can someone tell me what do I have to do with this? Given that I'm telling you this is what it is, what should I do now? Just to provoke some thought. What do you think we should do with this? So I am saying this is a Gaussian mixture of various population. The normal densities are mixing up. So what do I need to, in order to start using it, what do I need to know? Somebody?
So it's parameters.
Exactly, right? So this is we are still in the parametric space. So what are the parameters that makes a GMM? So let us call this as F. So your F of X, okay, so this is the heights of females, let us say in Europe or some other place where there are three regions. Okay, it is consisting of a mixture of three Gaussians. So the first mixture has some density, this is okay. Then the second mixture has some proportion. So this mu one represents the proportion of people who are present. Okay, mu two is the second, and like something like this, mu three, F three. Okay. And in each of this, I need to estimate what is mu1, sigma1, what is mu2, sigma2, okay. So mu3, sigma3. Okay, this is what we need to do. We need to estimate all the mu's. We need to estimate all the sigma. So when I put a dot bar here, I'm saying mu1, mu2, mu3, collectively, I'm calling it as a single vector, and sigma, and then, I'm sorry, this mu and mu, there is a confusion, right? So let us call this as lambda1. Lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3. And then we also need to learn the lambdas. So this is called as a Gaussian mixture model. Okay, so I went a little ahead and I presented you the overall plan, but we still have to wrap up Bayesian before we come. How do you estimate these quantities? That is what is discussion on EMs, which are again EM algorithm, which is again very, very important algorithm, which you will see a lot of applications for various types of machine learning cases, which are called as latent variable methods, variational inference, hidden Markov models. There are too many applications. So this will lead us to the next discussion, which is expectation maximization algorithm. Okay, or EM. So this will be the course plan for next few classes. Okay. Anyway, so yeah, let me just quickly ask people if there are any questions in this so far. Yes, Lakshmi, you're right. That is what we were supposed to find. Okay. So are there any questions in the plan or so far, any discussion that we have had? Anybody has any questions here? Are things clear? Let's move on then. So so let's move on. So moving on, so Bayes classifier, the Bayesian estimate, we need to wrap up. Okay, so let us do that now. So let's just briefly recollect what we have been doing for Bayesian estimation. Okay, so Bayesian estimation will also be useful when you have something called as online learning. So it is related to that as well. And I will ask you to do some kind of a mini project here. So that will come. So it is also going to be completely a Bayesian method. Okay, so that will happen. So it's useful. Ideas are useful even in online learning algorithms. So you will see this in some time. So it's a useful method, and it is something worth to study. All right. So so MLE, basically what we did in MLE is we just use what data is given, right? For instance, in Bernoulli, we saw that this is what is going to be given by MLE. So let me write capital M. So this is what is MLE output. But what we would like to do is, instead of trying to look at MLE like this, what we said is, let us assume that there is a prior, so which we call this as FP. Okay, and this prior, we said it's a beta distribution. Okay, so beta distribution has this shape. I mean, this thing. Okay, this is called as gamma. This called as a gamma function. So gamma of a. Okay, so I will tell you what this gamma is a little bit, but essentially this is the form of the beta distribution. Okay, so this is a beta distribution with parameterized by two unknown parameters a and b. Okay, so if a equal to b equal to 1, what you have is essentially this p takes always the value between 0 and 1. So if you take a equal to b equal to 1, the fp for that will be uniform. Okay, so what is this saying? So it is saying essentially that I don't know anything about where the value of p is lying. Okay, so this parameter p that I would like to know, I don't know exactly where it lies. So it's possible that it will fall anywhere between 0 and 1. Suppose if a is equal to 100 let's say b is equal to 10. Okay, so essentially this will have a much more stronger element of prior. So that means I am more or less, let me just draw it properly. So I'm more or less sure that I'm more or less sure that p is somewhere at 1/10. Okay, because you know, so the expected value of a beta distribution, expected value of this beta of 100, 10, this is going to be 10/100+10, which is 110. So this is roughly, okay, let me write this properly. So it is, I'm more or less sure that it is this, and it is a line, most weight will be lying in a small interval around this. Okay, so this is where beta distribution is useful. So as and when you get more and more sample, you get better and better learning. Okay, we saw this, and then we also saw what happens when you have what is the posterior of this. Okay, and I said that this is beta a plus summation xi and then b plus n minus summation xi. So this is what we saw, and I said I will give you some idea about what is this gamma of a. Gamma of a is a normalizing constant. Okay, so if I really have to integrate this, I will get some normalizing constant. The way, instead of writing it as a single number, why it has been written in this form is because this is a very meaningful entity. Okay, it's a generalization of the factor, factorial. It's a generalization of the factorial idea. Okay, so that's why it's been written in this way. So it has some interesting feature, but the definition of this, I will ask you to do some small assignment to just get familiar with this object, but it's essentially not important for the course as such. Okay, so it is given by something like this. Gamma of A is this. Okay, so it's an interesting object and it has uses, but let's not dwell too much on it. Okay, so you will see what and all the things you can be done, all these things you can do. So now what I said yesterday is that, so in the Bayesian estimator, you have a prior and you have a posterior, and the idea is the prior and the posterior, if they share the same same form, then it is very good, because then you can keep updating it in a stage by stage. So more data you get, you update it once again, and then you can keep on improving your beliefs. Okay, so these are also called beliefs. The priors are also called beliefs. Okay, so that is the advantage of having prior and posterior in the same form. It is an easy update. All right, and that's a desirable thing. And with this, I also said that, see, finally, at the end of the thing, right? So you need, what is the whole idea of estimation? You want to finally make some kind of a conclusion, right? So for instance, if you look at class conditional densities, right? So once you have mu and sigma, you will use it for your inference. You will find the posterior, and then you will say, which class that thing came from. So finally, you need some mu and some sigma in the case of normal. In the case of Bernoulli, you need some p. You cannot give a distribution and then say, okay, that distribution is fine. So you need to really process it. Okay, so the idea then we discussed was taking this posterior, what do we do with it? So essentially, we want to pull out a single representation. Okay. From the posterior. Okay. So again, this is again, if you want, if we want to pull out, then what we can do, there are two choices. Yesterday we saw, either you take mean of the posterior, or you take mode of the posterior. Okay, if you take the mode of the posterior, then the estimate is called as MAP estimate. Okay, so let me just explain what do you understand by the mean?
The expectation of.
Yes, so mean is the expectation. So this is easy. So mean is essentially mean of some x is actually expectation of x. Okay, so suppose if I have a normal distribution, the mean is basically the expectation of this entire thing, and it will actually turn out to be mu. Okay, so what about the mode? What is the mode of something? What is mode of a random variable x? How do I tell this?
So the observation occurring with highest frequency.
Yes, so that is correct. So the idea is observation with highest frequency. My spelling may be mistaken, but anyway, so basically if there is a for the case of continuous, there is no such thing as highest frequency, but what you have is a density. Okay, so something like this. Suppose this is some density, the mode of this will be, this is called as the mode. The highest, the value of the density which is at highest point, that is called as the mode. Okay, where this may be the mode for this, this is the mode, and expectation mean will be somewhere here, right? This could be the, let me not write like this. So this will be the mean and this will be the mode. Why this is the mean? Because this is roughly the center of mass of this object. So mean is also thought of as center of mass or center of gravity. So this, if you lift this entire shape at one point so that it balances, that is essentially how the mean is. Okay, so this is the mean and this is the mode. In general, the mean and the mode need not be the same. Okay, so if you want to find a mode of a beta distribution, how would one go about it? So I want to find basically what is the thing. So I have FP, which is going to be given by p to some constant time p to the power of a minus 1 and 1 minus p to the power of b minus 1. So what is the mode? Mode, how do I find the mode?
Global maximum.
Sorry, yeah, you global just yeah you just take the derivative of this density and find out solve for what value of p. The derivative is zero, right? So that is the same idea that we have been seeing consistently. So we just take the derivative and set it to zero. So that will give us k times a minus 1 into p. Let me write in a different color because it's getting a little crowded. Okay, plus k times p a minus 1 times b minus 1 into 1 minus p to the power of p minus 2. This is equal to 0. Okay, so now what we will do is we will divide throughout by p to the power of a minus 2 and b 1 minus p to the power of b minus 2. So that will give us, and k also we will remove. It will give us a minus 1 times 1 minus p, okay, plus b minus 1 times p. This is equal to 0. Okay, so this is the p which solves this. So we should essentially call it p star. Okay, but anyway, you know what this is. So now when you try to simplify this, what you will get is, so let's do this. So a will be having, there is a mistake I did. So when I take the derivative, I will get b minus 1, 1 minus p to the power of b minus 2 into, I have to take the derivative of 1 minus p, which will give me a minus 1. Okay, so there will be a negative 1 here. Anyway, so if you do the algebra properly, you will get p is equal to a minus 1 by a plus b minus 2. So this is your, this is going to be our map estimate. Okay, so essentially for the posterior of this form, right? So when we come to this here, the map estimate for this, map estimate of FP given data, this is going to be A plus summation xi minus 1 divided by A plus B plus N minus summation xi minus 2. Okay. So this is the map estimate, the single number which captures our understanding of the data. Okay. So now I told you when A is equal to B is equal to 1, okay, I am having uniform prior, which means it is a non-informative prior. I don't get any information about the distribution, about the prior. Okay, so when I say my prior belief of P is like this, that means I don't know anything essentially. So if I put A equal to B equal to 1, map estimate will become, what does it become? So if you see, so I'm sorry, this will not be there, right? Because this and this will cancel out. So it's going to be just this. Okay. So when I put A equal to B equal to 1, my map estimate will become summation xi by n, which is nothing but MLE estimate. Okay. So so that actually brings us to the end of discussion on Bayesian estimation. I will do only one example. Okay, I don't want to spend too much time doing this. I will give you some reading to do and some assignments to finish off this entire topic. It's essentially, the rest of it is going to be like a algebra, working out things, so that you can do it at your own time. But I hope the idea itself is clear. Okay, so maybe I think this is a good time to just pause and ask if people follow what's going on. Okay, so can I just have a quick poll to see if everyone is okay so far? Rohit, do you have any questions? There are two Rohits who have become unusually quiet. Is everything okay? Okay. I mean, this is a simple topic, so I wouldn't be surprised if you don't have questions, but wanted to check. All right. Okay, so that brings us to an end to this topic of Bayesian estimation. Okay, so I will give you some other exercises for you to do, where you will have some prior on some learning problem, means some estimation problem. Then you will get some data, and I'll ask you to produce the posterior. Then I will ask you to interpret it. So, okay, so things, when does the map estimate become MLE and things like that, I will ask you to do later. Okay, so it is an important topic, but there are so many things that we would like to touch upon. So I don't want to dwell on too many details. Okay, so now we are back to the Gaussian mixture model, which is again a very important method. So we will come to that now. So the motivation I have already given you. So what you have is, like, you have a density f of x, which is combination of several things. And whatever, so there could be many more. Okay, so I said, I did a mistake again. I shouldn't write mu. So this is lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda k. Okay, so what is given to you? It is important to know what data is given. The data that is given is only the x's. Okay, so let me tell. So xi, I equal to 1 to n. So let me again try to be a little more precise and clear for all of you. So what I'm saying is, you have this mixture, right? So you have, some type of a group like this. Okay. So something like this, and then basically this is coming from three underlying population. Okay, so this is my fx of x, right? This is what a mixture, Gaussian mixture will look like. Now, I have not told you what is the groups, which group it belongs to. Okay, so I have not told you, this is, let us say this is group one. Okay, this is group two or group three. Okay, in other words, this is also called as cluster one. It's also called as cluster two. And it's also called as cluster three. Okay, so now there are three underlying clusters, and each of these clusters I will call it as Zi's. Okay, so I is equal to 1 to n. Okay, this is like three groups whose clusters, whose allocation, I mean, if I really go and measure the height of these people, okay, I can either measure the height, and I can also ask what is your ethnicity, right? I can ask you which group do you belong to. Okay, this question can be asked, but suppose we cannot ask this question, we can only measure the height. Okay, so then we are having an issue of latent variable. Okay, latent variable. And what is the meaning of latent? Latent means also hidden variable. Okay, so the Z's are hidden. Okay, so what is the problem? So what you have is essentially a mixture density which is coming from three different groups. Okay, and what you are observing is just the excess. You don't observe which underlying groups they are. Okay, so that is the whole problem. You are supposed to look at only the excess and still estimate all the unknown parameters like lambda, mu's and sigmas. Okay, so that is the problem. Okay, so this is where Gaussian mixture model becomes challenging. If the Zi's are known, then it is essentially you take the entire X and Z. If you knew everything, including X and Z, what you do is you separate it out into three different groups, and then you apply MLE on each group. That will actually address the problem. So if you knew Z, things are easy, right? Can everyone see that? If you knew Z perfectly, you just slice out the particular Z's and then you just look at the estimation in isolation. Okay. Is this clear? Is the problem context clear to people?
Sir, can I repeat once more?
Okay, so who asked me this? Just to get an idea.
Vipul.
Okay. Vipul, so basically what I'm saying, see, the whole Bayesian base classifier, what we did was we had to estimate these class conditional densities, right? So, and then what we did was in the parametric space, we assumed that the class conditional densities are normal exponential. They are very nice shape. Okay, normal is a very nice shape with just two parameters you have to learn. Exponential is a very nice shape with only one parameter to learn and things like that. Okay, now what I'm saying is when you come to real problems, it may not be that a single density will be a good representation within the class also. See, I told males and females are actually normally distributed, but I'm saying perhaps this is not really accurate. There could be like, even within females, it could be like this. And with males, there could be some things like this. Vipul, does that make sense why this might happen? It could be a mixture of three different type of population, right? This could be all females and this could be all males. Correct, Vipul?
Yes, sir.
So what we are saying is we cannot assume that a simple density captures all the intricacies of the population. So that is why we have to assume that, suppose if you want to assume, it's again dependent on the problem, okay? It may or may not be true. So this is where Bayes classifier requires you to know how the population is, okay? It really needs you to know how the data samples are coming from. Okay, so suppose you determine that it is actually coming from a mixture, which means there are three different clusters of people and each cluster has different mean, mu and variance. The problem is we have to estimate the cluster ratios, which is lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda k. And we have to also estimate the class conditional densities of each of the clusters. Okay, so this is within a single class. There are multiple groups within the single class. Each group is called as a cluster. Okay, Vipul, and the problem is we don't know Z's. We don't know the clusters itself.
Okay, sir.
Yes. So that is why, so the whole idea is we want to learn this. So this is where we are heading to. and this is called as a latent variable or a hidden thing. Okay. All right. So I hope since he asked something, it should have helped others also. So let us move on. So from here, what we are going to do is we are going to move on. So we have to learn, basically the problem is clear. You have a Gaussian mixture model or a mixture model. So this both are mixture model. Okay. So there are some hidden variables, which are called as Zs. Okay. And what you would like to know, and these are also called as clusters. Okay, so your f is actually lambda 1 f1 plus something like lambda 2 f2. Let us just write only two, but you can extend it for many more. The idea is to learn the entire space just by looking at data, which is this. Okay, so this whole business must remind you of k-means. Okay, and see. Right, so k-means also is kind of similar. So what we will do is first we will recall k-means, and then we will see how k-means helps us to learn these parameters also. Okay, so the way we will develop this is first through a thorough discussion on k-means, and then we will then come to the general problem and see how we can draw parallels. Okay, so let's do that. So k-means is a clustering algorithm. So have you seen k-means before? Yes, somebody? Have you seen k-means before? Okay, Tushar has seen, but what about others? Okay. How about the UG students? Okay. So how is that possible? Siddharth says no, and somebody says yes. Okay. Anyway. Oh, all right. Okay. Maybe Siddharth, someone has already read on their own. So that's fine. So we will do k-means now. And since people have not seen it, we have to do it little more. Thing, and this is an extremely useful algorithm. Okay, so this is the first unsupervised thing that you will learn. So let me explain what is a supervised versus unsupervised. So in a supervised problem, what happens is you are given your x's and your y's. Okay, so you are given 1 to n. Okay, so this is your data set. You are given x and y. What you need is a hypothesis, you need some kind of a hypothesis which can tell, which can predict from your feature space, it can predict what y's to report. Okay, so this is what is supervised. You are given y's and you need to predict this. Unsupervised does not have, this is supervised. Okay, unsupervised, there are no labels y. Okay, so let's take an example, a popular example, and then you will understand the difference even more better. Okay, so in a vending machine, so let me I'm trying to, since people have not seen k-means, I have to motivate it more properly. So I'm just explaining this in fairly detailed way. So we will come back to the Gaussian mixture case and everything later, but first, let us do k-means a little more properly. Okay, so if you look at basically this coin vending machines. Okay, so let us look at this. So these are popular in some countries. In India also, it is there, but not everywhere. So what essentially you have is like a big box where there is all these drinks are there. Okay, and then some chips is there. And all these kinds of foods are there. And then there is a slot where you put in coins and notes. So this is for notes, and there is for something for coin. And then basically, depending upon the amount you have turned in, you can get one of these products. through a box like this. Okay, so this is very similar to your weighing scale that you have seen in in your railway station and all, right? So there is a weighing scale like this. You all would have seen this. Okay, so you stand on this and then you put this and then it will throw out a small ticket which says what is your weight. Okay, so if you look at a coin vending machine, there are basically different types of coins. Okay, so for let's say there are 25 paise coin, 50 paise coin, 1 rupee. Okay, now 25 paise is not there. So let us say there is 1 rupee coin. Okay, so 1 rupee, so this is height and this is weight. Okay, so if you look at the 1 rupee coins, there will be height or let's say diameter. Okay. So the 1 rupee coins, if you look at how the 1 rupee coins look, there will be some variation. Why? Because there are different years in which these coins are made, different materials in which it is made. Okay, so this is what you will get for 1 rupee. And then for 5 rupees, if you see, the diameter is low, but the weight is more. So diameter is so something like this, it will be. So this is the 5 rupee coin. Okay, so it will have some kind of a distribution like this. And if you pick the 10 rupee coin, the diameter is more, the weight is less than the 5 rupees. So you will have, I don't know, just to make it look a little pretty, I will write it here. Okay, this is not exactly to scale, but you understand that there are. Okay, so this is now. If you have, if you do some data collection, this is what you will get. Okay, so a coin vending machine, given a new coin, it has to be able to tell whether it is a 1 rupee coin or whether it is a, so this is 1 rupee or this is, you know, 5 rupee or 10 rupee. So you need to be able to distinguish this, right? So if you treat this as a supervised learning problem, what you get is you know the dimensions of every coin. So dimensions of every coin, this is called as X1, this is called as X2, and the colors are the Y's. Okay, so Y can be blue, then so instead of saying blue, let me say 1 rupee, or it can be 5 rupee, or it can be 10 rupee. So this is when you look at this problem, if you want to find out for a new coin what you have to put. Okay, so having 1, 5 and 10 is like a supervised learning problem. Okay, if you don't have 1, 5, 10, if you just have, if you don't have the labels, okay, so if you just assume that there are no labels, you just have the dimensions of several coins, and if you plot it, okay, without knowing what the underlying thing is, this is what you will have. I somehow thought you would have learned k-means in plus in the AI course. Anyway, so this will be your X1, this will be your X2. So this is unsupervised. Okay, so now I don't know what is the thing. Okay, I don't know what are all the Y's. Okay, in the unsupervised learning problem, what I'm interested to do is clustering. Okay, I'm interested to do clustering. So essentially what I want to do is I want to group the points into 3 different clusters, and I want to find out the clusters. Okay, so suppose if I want to do this, what is the thing that I have to find out? So what is our end goal? Can someone tell me, looking at the description of the problem, what is our end goal here? I'm asking people who have not seen clustering before. Okay, otherwise I will think that my explanation has been good, but if you have already seen clustering, this is kind of a repetition, but you have to bear with it. But for those of you who haven't seen k-means or who haven't seen clustering, what is the end goal here? What would you like to do?
Anybody? So we can find the means of all the clusters, that is what.
So essentially, thanks Devansh. So what you would like to do is you would like to find out what is the center of each of these things. Okay. So you would like to find out what is the center. So these are called as the centroids. Okay, centroids they are called for whatever reason. You would like to find out the centroids for k equal to 3 clusters. Okay, so k equal to 3 is chosen by the engineer. Okay, so k, what k you have to choose is chosen by the engineer. It's not given to us. You cannot learn k also. Okay, what in other words? In other words, we do not learn k. So k is something that is given as a parameter. Okay, so once Devansh, once we have the centroids or the means, what is it? What are the clusters? How do you define the clusters?
All the nearby points towards the centroid will be forming a one cluster.
Okay, so that is what you will do. So this is an easy idea, right? So whichever, so now given that there is a point, new point, let us suppose it comes over here. So let me use a different color. Suppose there is a new test point which comes here. What you do is, which cluster is it closest to, you find out. And then since it is closest to cluster one, so calling this as cluster cluster one, okay, calling this as cluster two and cluster three, the new point which I get, which is like your analogous to your testing when you're actually deploying this model, when a new coin comes, you find out which cluster is it closest to and you put it there. Okay, so this is what is the end goal of clustering. Okay, so this is the whole idea. So I hope this is clear to everybody. So what is the problem you are given? So let me again rewrite this figure. So we know what to do once you know the cluster centers, but actually when you start, you don't know the cluster centers, right? So that is the whole problem. So when I start, I don't know the cluster centers. All I have is points. Okay, so this is x1, this is x2. So I don't know the cluster center. The goal is to learn the cluster centers. Okay, so that is where k means gives. So k means takes. So let us write that. So k means input is all the xi's. Okay, I equal to 1 to n. So in this case, xi is having two components, x1 and x2. All these you collect and give it as an input. And output, okay, is going to be cluster centers, which are typically written as mu's. So mu1, mu2, and mu3. Of course, input also is taking how many clusters you want. So in this case, I'm giving k equal to 3. So this is the scheme. And once you have the output mu1, mu2, mu3, then what you have to do is clear. So any new point comes, you find out which distance to which of them is the nearest, and then you assign to that cluster. Okay, so is the formulation of the problem clear to people? Can I just quickly check, because this is an important topic. Okay, so everybody seems to be clear here. That's good. Okay, so now when you have something like this, how do we actually solve this problem is a issue. Okay, so there is one extremely trivial algorithm. K means is a trivial algorithm, but it's surprising that it works. Okay, so let us just write the algorithm itself. So what you do, so let's see the K means algorithm. Okay, initialize initialize mu1, mu2, mu3 of 0. So the initial guess, okay? So this is my initial guess randomly from the n points. So this is the first step. So what I will do is I will look at this data. I will choose 3 points randomly as a cluster center. Random. This is absolutely random. Okay. So I could, for instance, So let us do this simultaneously so that we can see how this algorithm evolves. Okay. So. You will see a lot of sketches here, but so when I pick 3 points, if I am lucky, I will get 3 points in 3 different clusters, but that will not happen. Mostly what will end up happening is I will choose one here, okay, and I may choose two other cluster centers somewhere, one here and one here. Okay, so from the given point itself, I have to pick 3 points, and I will pick, when I pick, I will get something like this. Okay, so this is my initial guess of the centroid. So this is not a good guess. So what we need to do is we try to improve this guess. Okay, so now there is a loop. So we will loop. So let us say, instead of writing loop, let us say repeat till convergence. So what is that convergence? I will explain. So what do you do? The first step is So the first step, what we do is I am not happy in the way I have written. So there are two things you can do. Either you can choose this randomly. There are two choices. Okay, so this is choice one. Choice two is I will. I will randomly assign clusters. So each point I will randomly choose clusters, random clusters, which means I will choose, there are all these points, right? So what is this choice? This is choice one. I'm just explaining all the possible variations, but you shouldn't get confused. Choice two is you have these points. Okay, so I will randomly choose points into different clusters. So I will say these points are cluster one, even though they aren't, I will choose something like this. Then cluster two, I will say these points are cluster two. And then I will say these points are cluster three, even though they are absolutely not, they are nicely mixed. Okay, I will do something like this. So do you follow? These are the two different things you could do. Okay, so and then you are clearly not in the correct cluster. So we have to improve. So what do we do in these steps? So what I will do is first thing I will say, if I use choice one, suppose if I randomly initialize the muse, then based on choice one, so let me just focus on choice one itself, because that is a very intuitive thing. So if I'm going with the choice one, what I do next is find assignments for every point. So what I'm saying is look at all the points. So these are the three randomly chosen centroids. I will then find out which are the points closest to them, and I will put them in clusters. So this will be one cluster. Okay. And this will be another cluster, and this third one will be another cluster. So this way I will assign. Okay. Find assignments for every point. Is that clear? What happened here? I need some kind of a response since there is, we are running out of time. I will just.
Yes, sir, it was clear.
Yeah, yeah. So now, so there are these three cluster centers. So next step will be recompute your centroids. Okay. So recompute centroids means you, whichever has been assigned as one of these clusters, you find out what is the centroid for this. Okay. So I will use in a different color. So the centroid for these center set of points will be this. Okay. The centroid for these set of points will be somewhere here, and the centroid for these set of points will be here. Okay. So that way you do this, and then you repeat. Okay. So now, if I were to repeat this, what is the next step I need to do? Let me repeat this. So I will use another color. So this is iteration two. So this was iteration one, okay, with the choice one, iteration one. Okay, in iteration two, what happens? I will have all the points, okay? As before, the points are still there. But now I have different cluster centers. So one of them is somewhere here. From the previous thing, whatever I have to use that. Okay, so this is the other one. And the other, this one is here. Okay, so this has become my new cluster center. Fine. So now this is my starting point. Now I will find assignments. So this is one set of assignment. Perhaps now I will get a few more points from here, and then I will get things like this. This will be my next assignment. Okay, so this is the first step. So this circling is the first step. This is what happens then. And then I have to recompute my assignment. So let me do that. So I am out of color, but when I recompute this, I will again have a new center. I will have a new center here, and then perhaps I will have a new center over here. Okay. So now this is iteration two. In iteration three, I think we are almost done, because you know, we are almost getting the correct clusters. And each time what you will do is you will find each. So what is this convergence business? Okay, so what is this convergence? Okay, so what does that mean? So okay, let me ask this into the class. So what is a, when do you say this algorithm has done well? Can someone tell me?
When going from one iteration to the other iteration, there's hardly any relabeling.
That is correct. So mathematically, that is very correct. So if there is no relabeling, I'm more or less done. But can I mathematically measure how good a particular cluster is with respect to other? Mathematically, can there be something that I can do?
Mu k minus xi for every cluster.
Sorry?
The difference between the centroid and the cluster, each cluster point for that cluster.
Okay.
The absolute value of that or square.
Yeah, okay. So what we are supposed to do is whatever you said is correct. So what we will do is basically what is cluster allocation? So I don't know if it was Bhavana who spoke, but anyway, so the cluster allocation is Zi, right? So this is cluster allocation. So this can be 1, 2, or 3. This is my cluster allocation. Okay. Then what is the second thing I have learned? I have learned the centroids, which is mu1, mu2, mu3. Okay. So what I will say is whatever you said, who was it who spoke before?
Sanish.
Yeah. Okay. So what we said is we will look at how good a cluster is by looking at this. Okay, I will sum over all the points, okay, and I will look at all possible clusters that are there. If a particular point is there in one cluster, so that is Zij. Okay, what is Zij? Zij is equal to 1 if Zi is equal to j. Okay, so if I have something like this, Zij, so then I will see what is the distance I am having from this point, which is xi minus mu j. I will look at the distance. Okay, so this is the this is like the second L2 norm. Okay, so I will look at this distance, which is basically x1 minus mu1, so xi1, okay, minus mu j1 whole squared plus xi2 minus mu j2 whole squared. Okay, so this distance I will see. And whichever minimizes this, okay, maybe I can even take an average. Whichever minimizes this, that is what is I am looking for. Okay, so basically my objective is to find Zij comma mu j's so that this is minimized. So this is what is called as a how good a particular cluster is. This is how we measure it. Okay, so is the idea and how it works clear to people? Yes, is it clear? this whole discussion?
Sir, can we get the following idea for convergence? Like that was in my mind. So when we are going from one iteration to the other, when we are recomputing centroids, if the new computed centroid is very close to the previous one, like when it lies within a range, like what we use in numerical analysis.
Yeah, that is also a good method to find out convergence. That is okay. That also you could do. Okay, but you can also look at, whoever Bhavana said that you can see whether the assignments themselves are not changing much. Because if the assignments don't change, the cluster centers don't change. So both are equivalent. Okay. All right. So let me just try to little bit give you an importance for this k-means, how important this is. Okay. See, so typically, you know, when you have a machine learning problem, okay, you will have features. Too much data also is a problem. What do I mean by that? So given, suppose if I want to do a function learning, you want to do a regression. Okay, so this is regression, which means, you know, this is like your house price. If I want to predict given features, okay, which are like x1, x2, there are many, many more features than what is necessary. Okay, sometimes that will happen. Okay, and in two dimensions, you can tell, okay, these are all houses of type 1. This is houses of type 2, houses of type 3, like that you can tell by looking at the data. But sometimes that will not be the case. You will have so many features, you cannot look at the data also. So what you do is, before you really start your supervised learning problem, where you are actually trying to regress for y based on all the x's, what you do is you reduce the dimensionality a little bit by creating a new feature, which is going to be like the cluster centers that you are going to learn. You will first do k-means, you will get some cluster centers, you will add that to your every xi as a new feature, and then you will use your machine learning algorithm, and many times it will do better. Okay, so don't go directly to your deep learning approach. These kind of pre-processing steps, if you use k-means, if you use all these simple ideas, they will do far better than some of the other more advanced algorithms, which have some other issues that we will discuss at some point. Okay, so k-means is a very important algorithm. I hope you have all understood this. Okay, so this will come back again when we are doing Gaussian mixture models. Again, we will have to revisit k-means in a different way, and then you will see why I brought k-means in this discussion. Okay, so all right. So I think this is about it, what I wanted to tell. So if there are any questions, please feel free to ask now. Is everything clear so far, everyone?
Sir,
yeah, Rajneesh, tell me.
Sometimes it may be possible that if we are trying to predict three different clusters, like here,
yeah.
So cluster one and cluster two, they are made one cluster, and there is a bifurcation in cluster three only. So
yes,
we are,
yes. What you are raising? So that is a good point. So sometimes when your clusters are pretty close by, so let us take an example. Okay, so when you have clusters which are like this, okay, so ideally from the eye I can tell this is the three clusters. Okay, but sometimes what happens is you will have things like this. You will have so instead of doing this way, you may have like this clusters. Something like this, and you can have the third cluster over here. Your algorithm can converge to this. Okay, this can happen. Okay, this is not really how we wanted, but depending upon the way we have initialized, you may end up here. Okay, so this is this kind of a solution is called as a global optimum solution. Okay, global optimizer. This is called as a local optimization, local optimizer. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is, if you treat, so any function, right, if you want to maximize a particular value of function, there is an f. Okay, so if it has multiple modes like this, something like this, okay, so this is f of x. Okay, so and I want to maximize, find out the x which maximizes f of x. So these are, this is the best, this is called as a global maxima. Okay, These other associated peaks are locally maximum. These are all called as local maxima. Okay, so when you are running an algorithm such as k-means, there is a known problem that you may end up in a local optimum. Okay, so that can happen, and there is no solution for it. All you can do is, if you are worried about that, you run this multiple number of times. Okay, when you run it multiple number of times, sometimes you will get better solutions. You keep comparing every time it has converged, you keep comparing this measure. Okay, so first run you got a value which is 25, second run you got 35, third run you got 12. Okay, this measure. So which one will you use, Rajnish?
Maximum one.
12 one, right? So this way, yes, you can improve it. Yeah, so this is the way in which you can fix it, this kind of problems, but it does happen. So this is an important point that you brought. Okay, so that's about it. So I think I will stop here. I will hang back if there are any questions. So let me stop here. So have a good lunch, everybody. Thank you.